The Earth's rotation and revolution. Okay, so why do we have to study and spend so much time contemplating astronomy to understand just the simple weather and climate that we experience on our planet? What is studying astronomy? What do we benefit? How do we benefit from studying astronomy? Well, the study of the Earth-Sun relationship is really necessary in order to understand the mechanisms which deliver energy to the Earth. We have to understand how the geometric relationship between the Earth and the Sun operate, because that relationship affects and influences and essentially controls the intensity of the energy which the Earth receives. So the effects of the changing geometry, the tilt of our planet, has a tremendous influence, in fact, on the long-term weather and long-term global climate. Okay, so why does the Earth's revolution make a difference to Earth's climate? Well, actually, it doesn't have as much impact as what you might think. Okay, so it takes us essentially 365 days to complete one complete revolution around the Sun. Our path around the Sun is not a perfect circle. It's elliptical. The perihelion, which occurs around January 3rd, is our closest approach to the Sun. So it's the closest the Earth comes to the Sun. It's about 147 million miles. Okay, the aphelion, which occurs around July 3rd, is the furthest distance from the Earth to the Sun. So that's when we are furthest away from the Sun. We're about 153 million miles away from the Sun. So it's a difference of about 6 million miles, something like that. And when you do the math, it comes out to be about 3%. So it's an ellipse, but it's not that elaborate of an ellipse. Not like what the graphic here is exaggerated a little bit. So it's not as exaggerated as that graphic would indicate. So that 3% difference in distance between the perihelion and the aphelion is only about 3%. It does affect us a little bit, because it represents about a 7% change in incoming radiation, what we call insolation. Not insolation like what you put in your attic, but insolation, the radiation which reaches the Earth. So it has a little bit of effect, but it doesn't have as much effect as our planet's axial tilt. If the Earth is closer to the Sun in January, why do we have winter in January? Okay, so, well, it has more to do with, like I said, our planet's axial tilt than it does with our distance from the Sun. Okay, so while we are closer to the Sun in January, and we're receiving about 7% more energy from the Sun, our aspect, when I say aspect, what I mean is our orientation to the Sun, how we're pointed towards the Sun, and how we're pointed away from the Sun, that has far more influence on the amount of insolation that we receive from the Sun than the distance. Our seasons are controlled not by distance, but by our axial tilt of 23.5 degrees. So our planet is tilted on its axis by 23.5 degrees. We've discussed energy and how energy is measured, how it's transmitted. You know, we've talked about conductivity, we've talked about convection, and we've talked about radiation. Okay, so now we need to throw another player into this equation. We need to talk about the angle of incidence a little bit. As the angle of incidence plays a huge role in radiation and the intensity of the radiation that the Earth receives, and that role in the heating of the Earth's surface. Now, this sun angle, or what you'll also see referred to as the solar angle, the angle at which the sunlight strikes the Earth directly affects the energy that's received at any given location. So what are these equinoxes and solstices that we've heard about? Okay, the unique geometry between the Earth and the Sun provides four unique times of the year. These are positions along our revolution around the Sun. Solstices occur twice per year, when the Earth is at its maximum and its minimum distance. So when we're at our maximum distance from the Sun, that's when we have our summer solstice. When we're at the minimum distance from the Sun, that's when we have our winter solstice. The summer solstice usually hits us around June 21st, 22nd. The winter solstice usually hits us about the December 22nd, 23rd, thereabouts. Now, the equinox, the word term equinox comes from the Latin meaning equal night, occurs twice per year when the amount of energy received by the northern and the southern hemispheres is essentially equal. That occurs in March and in September. So we have the vernal equinox, or the spring equinox, and then we have the autumnal equinox in September. So the equinox implies the distance from the sun is equal at both times, and the sun's angle, the angle at which the sun's rays approach the earth, is 90 degrees with respect to the earth's surface at the equator. So I have to throw that caveat in there, is that we're making this measurement at the equator. So the graphic here illustrates this changing relationship over the course of 1 year. If we start at the top of the graphic, we can see the Tropic of Cancer, the equator, the Tropic of Capricorn, and then the Arctic Circle. At the top of the graphic, we're starting with the vernal equinox, so we're around March 21st, 22nd, and the incoming solar radiation is equal in both hemispheres. So they're both receiving equivalent amounts of radiation. Now, if we progressed to the summer solstice, June 21st, 22nd, the incoming solar radiation, the insolation, is greatest in the northern hemisphere. If we progress and then reach our September date, the autumnal equinox, now we're back to that similar situation that we had back in March, where both hemispheres are receiving approximately the same amount of solar energy. And then we have the winter solstice. So we're a little bit closer to the sun now, but we're also facing away from the sun, and that geometry allows us to have our winter season. So the winter solstice occurs usually around right before Christmas, around 21st or 22nd of December, and that's when our solar energy is greatest in the southern hemisphere, but it's also minimal in the northern hemisphere. Now, your book doesn't talk about the analemma, and I don't believe it even has a graphic. Maybe later on in the chapters it does. But the analemma is simply a graphic which helps describe the relationship of the sun and its transit over our skies. So an analemma is a graphic which describes the transit of the sun over the Earth's surface. In fact, the analemma tells us what day and where, the latitude, the sun is directly overhead. So the way this graphic works is you could pick, say, September. You could say, like, September 15th, which is near the center of our graphic. And so if I find September 15th and then I read across to the left, it tells me the declination of the sun is about 3 degrees above the horizon at the equator. So if I'm at a latitude of about 3 degrees north of the equator on September 15th, the sun will be directly overhead at a few minutes before noon. Okay, so that's what the sun fast at the top means. So if I read September 15th and I go up, it's going to be about 5 minutes before noon. That's the sun's going to be directly overhead about 5 minutes before noon. Now, with the sun slow part of this, now if I pick a date, let's pick a date in February, for example. Okay, if we go and look at, say, February 15th again, and we read directly across, now the sun's directly going to be directly overhead at about 13 degrees southern latitude. So I'm going to read up from February 15th, and it's going to lag by about 13 minutes. So it's actually going to be about 13, 14 minutes after noon, after local time, noon local time, when the sun is directly overhead. So that's how you would read the analemma. But that gives us a sense of how that geometry changes. And then later on, it helps us figure out just exactly how our radiation is being affected by sun angle. So can you summarize how all the geometry we've covered so far influences the amount of energy the Earth receives? Okay, we now know that the distance between the Earth and the Sun doesn't really affect us so much in the when it comes to our seasons. What really affects us is the geometry of the axial tilt of the Earth. It plays a far more role in the changing seasons, and for three primary reasons. First, the changing period of daylight over the course of a year. I think we all experience that. Second, the angle of the incidence of the incoming solar radiation changes, and so that has a great influence on this. And then third, the amount of atmosphere incoming radiation must traverse or must pass through before it reaches the Earth. So how does our period of daylight influence the energy we receive at the Earth's surface? Okay, this plays a big role in agriculture. Okay, so the growing seasons near the equator tend to be relatively long. They can double crop. Sometimes they can even triple crop, like in China, for example. And China's southern extent is closer to the equator than the United States' southern extent. And so they have the potential of triple cropping some crops in the southern part of China due in part to the fact that the extent of their land mass is closer to the equator, and so therefore they have greater amount of daylight hours available to them. Now, if you think about Europe sits much higher in latitude on the Earth's surface than the United States does, and that changes the amount of growing season that they have available to them. Their growing season, particularly like when you get to Norway and Sweden and Finland, their growing seasons are very, very short. Due to the axial tilt of the Earth, not every location receives the same amount of solar radiation over the same period of time. In summer, in the northern hemisphere, means the Arctic Circle receives nearly 24 hours of daylight, while in the Antarctic Circle is almost in complete 24-hour darkness. Now, that reverses in winter in the northern hemisphere. Our Arctic Circle is nearly in complete darkness, while the Antarctic Circle has nearly 24-hour sunlight. Okay, so this intensity of incoming radiation changes with latitude, and as I said earlier, I kind of got ahead of myself, but the growing seasons are shorter as one progresses towards the poles as the amount of daylight the Earth receives changes. So how does the solar angle influence the energy we receive at the Earth's surface? Well, again, this goes back to the idea of our axial tilt. When the sun is directly overhead, the intensity of energy land receives is much greater. If you go back and think about the equation we explored in the part about energy, remember the equation power per unit of area. Okay, so I have in brackets there, I say watts per square meter. As the solar angle changes, the energy does not change, but the area affected by the energy does. And so you can see if the energy coming in from the sun remains constant, but you increase the area, what happens to that, to the intensity? Well, if the wattage remains the same, but the area increases, well, the intensity has to drop off because the denominator is getting larger, the numerator is staying constant, and so eventually your intensity is going to decrease. And it decreases as a function of the sine of the angle. Take, for example, and I have a video that will explain this in detail. So at 90 degrees, when the sun is directly over the Earth's surface, and it's 90 degrees, which means it's perpendicular to the Earth's surface, the sine of 90 degrees is 1. So the incoming energy isn't really changing. In fact, it's not changing. 1 times anything is that value, right? But as the sun begins to change its angle in the sky versus the surface, as it becomes 3 o'clock or 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock and that sun angle changes, now we've got to consider this effect called beam spreading. And so the energy that's coming in, the value of the energy coming in or reaching the Earth is not the same, but now the area is changing. And so the effect called beam spreading needs to be taken into consideration. So we take the solar angle, like for example 45 degrees, so if the sun's 45 degrees over the with respect to the surface of the Earth, we've got to take the sine of 45, which is around 0.7, and so we take 0.7 times whatever the energy coming in is, and then we have intensity. If the sun angle is 30 degrees, for example, that's about half. It's 0.5. So we would take half of the energy. So you can kind of see, and I have a video that I'll show you that kind of illustrates this. So how does atmospheric interference influence the energy we receive at the Earth's surface? The less atmosphere the energy needs to pass through, the more energy reaches the surface. Because remember, the atmosphere is going to absorb, it's going to reflect, some of it's going to pass through, some of it's going to bounce back off the surface of the Earth and be reabsorbed into the atmosphere. And some energy, even when it hits the Earth, and some of it's going to end up being reflected back into space. So there's a lot of some very dynamic things that are occurring within the atmosphere. So the less atmosphere that incoming insulation has to deal with, the more insulation is going to strike the Earth and be used for some that energy. There's going to be an energy transfer that occurs. Thus, when the sun is directly overhead at solar noon, the incoming insulation passes through the minimum amount of atmosphere, and heating, that energy exchange, can take place very rapidly. At dawn and at dusk, when the sun angle is small, insulation must pass through a lot more atmosphere, and it becomes a lot more susceptible and vulnerable to absorption and reflection by clouds, absorption by water vapor in the air, reflection by ozone, absorption by methane, and so there's less energy that reaches the surface to heat, you know, our lakes, heat rivers, heat the ocean, heat atmospheric water vapor, heat the land, warm us. It can't really do all that stuff very well. So that has a great influence the intensity of the radiation that we receive at the Earth's surface. So we have atmospheric interference, we have solar angle, and we have period of daylight. You might also call it, this atmospheric interference also goes by another name of atmospheric beam depletion. So that's really the technical word for it, is atmospheric beam depletion. So those are the three primary mechanisms which can influence the heating and the energy transfer from the sun to the Earth, and it's based off of geometry. So that should go a little way towards explaining why we have to worry about these geometric relationships when it comes to examining the heat engine that drives our weather and determines overall climate.